We have finished introducing stochastic gradient descent. Next, we move to the fourth part where we continue discussing SGD. Specifically, we compare SGD with two other common algorithms, batch gradient descent and mini-batch gradient descent. The problem we are studying remains the optimization of an objective function, JW, using a set of samples. Assuming there are n samples, xi, we use them to optimize the objective function. We have three methods, BGD, where B stands for batch, MBGD, mini-batch gradient descent, and the previously discussed SGD. Let's see the differences between the three methods. For BGD, each time it uses all n samples to calculate the average. This can be considered the closest to the true expectation. For mini-batch gradient descent, not all samples are used. For example, if there are a total of 1 million samples, in each iteration of MBGD, only 100 or 1,000 samples are used. A set of samples is randomly selected from the 1 million, and this set is called IK. Assume this set has m samples, and the average is calculated on this set. SGD is straightforward. A single sample is randomly selected from the set, resulting in the stochastic gradient. In essence, MBGD can be considered to encompass BGD or SGD. Why? Because when the mini-batch size approaches 1, MBGD becomes SGD. When the batch size is large, it becomes BGD. Therefore, on the one hand, MBGD has less randomness than SGD because it uses more samples to calculate the average. On the other hand, MBGD uses relatively fewer samples than BGD, making it somewhat more random. However, since it does not require using all samples, it is more flexible and efficient. As I mentioned earlier, if the mini-batch size of MBGD is simply 1, then it becomes SGD. If the mini-batch size in MBGD is equal to n, there is an interesting point that many people may overlook. What is it? That is, MBGD does not become BGD, strictly speaking, in this case. Why? Although both BGD and MBGD use n samples, BGD uses all n samples, while MBGD randomly selects from the n samples. This means that some samples might be selected multiple times, while others might not be selected at all. This introduces a slight difference between the two algorithms. In many cases, this difference is negligible, but I hope you can understand this subtle difference mathematically. Now, let's use an example to illustrate the three algorithms. The example is the mean estimation problem we considered many times. I have n samples, and I want to calculate the mean x bar of these n samples. This problem can be equivalently formulated as an optimization problem, where we seek the minimum of this objective function. The objective function is w minus xi. Assuming this is a vector, both sides are the norm of vectors. Then we sum them up and average them. Note that there is a factor of 2, which is not because there are 2 n data points, but because it will cancel out when we calculate the gradient later. Specifically, for the function jw, the gradient with respect to w is 1 over n sigma w minus xi. You can verify this yourself. With this gradient, we can quickly derive the three algorithms, BGD, MBGD, and SGD. Let's start with BGD. Here is its gradient. In BGD, we sum wk n times and then average, which simplifies to wk. For xi, we sum it n times and then average, resulting in x bar. The only difference between BGD, MBGD, and SGD lies in the latter part. For MBGD, we take m samples from the set, calculate their mean, and use that. For SGD, we take just one sample, making it xk. Further, if we set alpha k equals 1 over k, we can explicitly get the expression of wk. In the case of BGD, wk plus 1 equals x bar directly, reaching the solution in one step because it uses all the samples. For MBGD, the process is slightly slower but faster than SGD because it averages a subset of samples every time, and wk plus 1 is the average of all the summed samples. For SGD, the process is the slowest since it averages over single samples. Next, let's look at a simulation result. We have introduced this result before, but I will explain it again. We have a 20x20 region, and we uniformly sample 100 points within it. We then apply these 100 points to the three algorithms we just discussed and observe their convergence behavior. In the figure, the red line represents SGD. As you can see, it converges relatively quickly, moving directly to the target region and then gradually converging to the true mean. The purple and blue lines represent mini-batch gradient descent with different batch sizes. The purple line corresponds to a smaller batch size of 5, and the blue line corresponds to a batch size of 50. You can observe that the purple line converges faster than SGD, directly approaching the target and then gradually converging to the mean. The blue line, on the other hand, converges even faster, getting very close to the target mean. The right figure provides a similar illustration. The x-axis represents the iteration step, and the y-axis represents the distance to the mean. You can see that with a batch size of 50, mini-batch gradient descent quickly reaches a distance very close to the target. In comparison, SGD is slower, but it still converges relatively quickly. This concludes all the content for this lecture. Let's summarize. In the first part, we introduce the mean estimation problem. The problem involves using a set of samples to estimate the expectation. Previously, we simply calculated the average of the samples to approximate the expectation. Now we know that we can use an incremental manner to achieve this. That is, as we obtain each sample, we compute the average incrementally, making the process more efficient since we do not have to wait for all samples. In the second part, we introduced a classic algorithm in the field of stochastic approximation, known as the Robbins-Monroe algorithm. This algorithm can find the root W star of the equation GW equals zero, where the expression of GW is unknown. What we know is that for a given W, we can measure the function value subject to noise or errors, represented by G tilde. The RM algorithm can be used to estimate W star using these noisy measurements. Next, we introduce the stochastic gradient descent algorithm. What problem does this algorithm solve? It deals with optimizing an objective function that looks like this, where we can sample its gradient. Using this stochastic gradient, WK can converge to the optimal solution, W star. The algorithms and concepts introduced in this lecture are very useful for two main reasons. First, in the next lecture, we will learn temporal difference learning. When you see those algorithms, you will not be surprised because they have similar incremental and iterative expressions to the algorithms discussed today. This lecture lays a solid foundation for the next one. Second, these algorithms are classic optimization methods. They are very interesting and have wide applications. This concludes our lecture. Thank you, and see you next time.